kidney failure. So now we know that there are many causes for kidney diseases or nephropathies. These causes can sometime leads to kidney failure. So kidney failure is divided into two. One is acute kidney injury and the other is chronic kidney disease. This acute kidney injury was previously called as acute renal failure, but now the renal failure word has been replaced by kidney injury. 30% of the ICU admissions are because of these acute kidney injuries. The common causes for these acute kidney injuries are severe diarrhea leading to hypovolemia, malaria leading to autoimmune reaction for malaria, earthquake injuries leading to severe trauma in the body, leading to acute kidney injuries. These acute kidney injuries, they are characterized by sudden impairment of kidney functions, which results in the retention of nitrogenous waste in the blood, that is creatinine and urea and uric acid levels goes up in the blood. These acute kidney injuries, they are reversible, and basically these acute kidney injury is not a disease, but it is a condition or it is a disease of kidney which leads to special symptoms which are labeled as acute kidney injury. So these are characterized by increase in serum creatinine levels, increase in blood urea nitrogen, and they are oftenly associated with oliguria, that is low output of urine. AKI is a clinical diagnosis. That means it is diagnosed clinically. It is not a structural diagnosis. Structural diagnosis means the damage to the kidney is the diagnosis is little different. For example, acute interstitial nephritis can lead to acute kidney injury, or acute glomerulonephritis, the disease of the glomeruli or disease of the ducts, can lead to acute kidney injury. So it is a clinical diagnosis, is not a structural one. For example, fever is a clinical diagnosis. The structural diagnosis for fever could be the malarial infection, like that. So AKI can range from asymptomatic, right, most of the time this is asymptomatic, or some transient changes only in the lab investigations, for example creatinine levels or GFR levels, and sometimes it is the symptoms are very fatal. For example, the blood volume, effective circulating blood volume decreases, the electrolyte levels destabilizes, and the acid base balance also goes off the track. So what are the causes for these acute kidney injury? The causes can be grouped into three categories. One is pre-renal, one is renal, and another one is post-renal. Pre-renal means pre to renal, previous to renal. The causes which are previous to renal, for example, heart causes and the cardiovascular causes. If the heart is not able to pump blood properly, which leads to reduced blood flow to the kidney, definitely the kidney will fail, because there is no proper blood flow and kidney requires huge amount of blood flow, a continuous supply of blood flow, leading to hypovolemia. So hypovolemia can be because of diarrhea. When the fluid is lost from the blood, the fluid is lost, diarrhea, blood loss, directly blood loss leading to hypovolemia, leading to low blood pressure, burns, diuretics, use of diuretics, diabetes can also lead to hypovolemia, because diabetes leads to polyuria, and polyuria can lead to hypovolemia. Low fluid intake, if somebody is not taking fluid intake, for example starvation. And other causes are hypoperfusion, when the perfusion of the kidney is not proper. Hypovolemia will ultimately lead to hypoperfusion only. For example, congestive cardiac failure, when the heart is not able to pump blood properly to the kidney, it will be hypoperfused. This hypoperfused means the kidney will go into ischemia, and that ischemic damage will ultimately leads to necrosis and necrotic damage. Liver failure leading to hypoalbuminemia, again leading to less circulating blood volume. Next is impaired renal autoregulation. If somehow the renal autoregulation, for example the RAS system, is not working properly under the influence of NSAIDs or ACE inhibitors or ARB inhibitors or cyclosporine drugs, some immunosuppressant drugs like cyclosporine, right? So these ACE inhibitors, ARBs, NSAIDs, they leads to impaired renal autoregulation, which leads to acute kidney injury. Another one is renal vascular disease. If the blood supply to the the renal artery is somehow damaged, for example in stenosis, in embolisms, in thrombosis, or some external compression because of some tumor, then it leads to hypoperfusion and ultimately leads to acute kidney injury. So the causes which are not in the kidney, which are pre to the kidney, which are previous to the kidney, are called as pre-renal causes for acute kidney injury, or it is also called as pre-renal azotemia. Azotemia means azo means nitrogenous products, and emia means blood. So more nitrogenous products in the blood is azotemia. So the causes for pre-renal acute kidney injuries are also called as pre-renal azotemia causes. Then renal azotemia, the causes in the kidney which leads to increased nitrogenous waste in the blood. For example, the disease of the glomeruli, first one, for example acute glomerulonephritis, we have already talked about this. Then tubulointerstitial diseases, the disease of the tubules, TCT, PCT, loop, and the interstitial tissues, mesenchymal cells. So this will lead to acute kidney injury. Example, acute tubulointerstitial nephritis and acute tubular necrosis, right? So these can lead to acute kidney injuries. Vascular diseases inside the kidney, if the blood vessels are damaged, for example vasculitis. Then there are post renal causes, after the post to the kidney, if there are some causes, if there is some obstruction in the ureter, in the bladder, or in the urethra, like ureteral calculus, tumors, compressions, blood clots inside the ureters or urethra, bladder outlet obstructions, so the bladder is not able to empty itself, for example benign prostate hypertrophy because of the swelling of the hypertrophy of the prostate gland, strictures in the urethra, or neurogenic bladder, the bladder is not able to push the urine effectively. Then the clinical features for acute kidney injury. The clinical features for acute kidney injury are peripheral edema. The edema in the body, the swelling in the body, is the most important clinical feature. The person starts to swell up. So weight gain because of that swelling, because of the retention of water in the interstitial, fluid is more. For that reason, person gains weight. Other symptoms of uremia. Uremia means excess of uric acid in the, excess of urea in the blood. So because of this uremia, the person develops certain symptoms, and the condition is called as uremic syndrome in acute kidney injury. For example, anorexia and vomiting. No food, the person does not want to take the food. Anorexia and vomiting are the main features of uremia. Others are fatigue, weakness, nausea, seizures, confusions, coma. Others are esterexis, that is means flapping tremors, hyperreflexia, the reflexes will be high, and the fluid accumulation in the lungs. There will be fluid accumulation all over the body, right? But if it goes, the fluid goes into the lungs, then it causes the fluid in the lungs, and dyspnea will develop, and crackles will also be heard on auscultation, right? Because of the pleural effusions. Then deranged blood pressure because of the hemodynamic instability. The blood pressure will fall. The effective circulating blood volume will decrease, thereby making the blood pressure to fall. Also the autoregulation by the kidney, by RAS system, will be deranged because of the kidney injury. So the blood pressure will be deranged. Pain in flanks, because the kidney might swell up if it is, the causes are inflammatory causes. For example, acute glomerulonephritis, then the kidney might swell up and there will be pain in flanks. Other symptoms are according to the cause. For example, if the person is going into acute kidney injury because of acute tubulointerstitial nephritis, which is mainly due to drug allergic reaction, for example some people are allergic to certain drugs, so in that cases, if the person is developing acute kidney injury, then there will be other symptoms like fever, like urticarial rash, fever, like that. The diagnosis, so there is one authority called as KIDCO, kidney disease, and IGO refers for something. KIDCO, kidney disease organization, in 2012 it gives us the criteria for diagnosing the, or for making the diagnosis of acute kidney injury. It says that if any of these three criteria are met, then the person can be said to be having acute kidney injury. For example, if the serum creatinine level increases by greater than 0.3 milligram per deciliter, right, and within 48 hours, or if it goes greater than 1.5 times above the normal within 7 days, or if it goes or the urine volume decreases by 0.5 ml per kg per hour for 6 hours. If the person is passing at this rate for 6 hours, then the person is said to be in acute kidney injury state. However, this acute kidney injury can be staged as well. It can be put into the staging. For example, it is the RIFLE criteria. RIFLE criteria refers to this acronym RIFLE: risk, inquiry, failure, loss, and end stage renal disease, RIFLE. So the person is said to be in the risk state of acute kidney injury if the creatinine levels are greater than 1.5 times, or the glomerular filtration rate, which is carried out with the help of the serum creatinine by putting the serum creatinine into an equation, if it decreases by 25%, or the urine output is less than equal to 0.5 ml per kg per hour for 6 hours. So like that, the acute kidney injury is staged into a risk category. Injury is the next category. If the serum creatinine is 2 times the baseline, or the GFR decreases by 50%, or the urine output is less than 0.5 ml for 12 hours. And failure, if the creatinine is greater than 3 times the baseline, GFR decreases by 75%, and the urine output is less than 0.5 ml or equal to 0.5 ml, less than equal to 0.5 ml for 24 hours. Right? Or anuria, that means 500 ml of urine in 24 hours for 12 hours. If the person is suffering with that condition, then definitely the person is in the failure stage. And last is the loss. Loss is complete loss for 4 weeks, greater than 4 weeks. It required hemodialysis. And the end stage renal disease, when this complete loss continues for greater than 3 months, we say the kidney has completely lost, completely died, and the kidney is in the end stage renal disease, which requires active hemodialysis. That means approximately once in 3 days, or twice in a week. So staging, this is once again, there are the KDIGO or has also staged the acute kidney injury based on these level. You can go through them. Then the next is chronic kidney disease. So chronic kidney disease is a long-standing progressive deterioration of renal functions. When the renal functions, they are deteriorated for a very long time, that means approximately equal to greater than more than 3 months or equal to 3 months. This chronic kidney disease is mainly because of some acute kidney disease which is manifesting, progressing for a long time. The most important, most common cause for chronic kidney disease in the world is diabetic nephropathy, which arises because of diabetes mellitus. High blood pressure is also leads to kidney nephropathies, for example hypertensive nephrosclerosis. Glomerular diseases, for example acute glomerulonephritis, they lead to chronic kidney disease. SLE, amyloidosis, CTIN, they all lead to chronic kidney diseases. However, we can summarize the chronic kidney disease causes or risk factors as diabetes, polycystic kidney disease, obesity, glomerulonephritis, and hypertension. So patients with chronic kidney disease, the mild to moderate chronic kidney disease, they do not have any symptoms except for the permanent elevations of blood urea nitrogen and creatinine above the normal level. The nocturia is often noted in these chronic kidney disease patients. They are oftenly complaining of nocturia because the kidney is unable to concentrate the urine and they have to pass the urine again and again. So the most of the times this chronic kidney disease is associated with polyuria, whereas the acute kidney disease is most of the time is associated with oliguria. Lassitude, fatigue, anorexia, decreased mental acuity, these are very common symptoms. The person might lose weight because of anorexia. There will be continuous fatigue and the mental acuity will be decreased. with severity of this chronic kidney disease, the person might be having neuromuscular symptoms like muscle twitches, peripheral sensory motor neuropathies, muscle cramps, hyperreflexia, restless leg syndrome, and seizures. Anorexia, pallor, tetany, nausea, vomiting, weight loss, stomatitis, pruritus, and unpleasant taste in the mouth. And also the skin changes, skin pigmentation changes, skin changes to yellow brown. Renal retention of sodium and water leads to dependent edema. That means the edema in the legs, it comes with the daytime, or edema in the sacral region comes if the patient is non-ambulatory. Dyspnea, because of the pleural effusions, or ascites, the person might develop ascites or pleural effusions. Hypertension is a very common sign, which is present in 80% of the patients with CKDs. Nails are also pigmented with brown lines. Uremic fetor, that means uremic smell, urea-like smell in the fecal matter. Uremic frost, the person might develop snow-like flakes over the skin because of the increased uremia and increased urea in the blood. Vitamin D deficiency, because kidneys helping in vitamin D regulations. Osteomalacia, again because of kidneys regulating the vitamin D levels. Advanced CKD, pericarditis and gastrointestinal ulcerations and bleeding may also occur because of the interference with the this blood clotting because of kidney diseases. The diagnosis is mainly made by the creatinine levels, and the glomerular filtration rate. Electrolytes, blood urea, nitrogen, phosphate, calcium and complete blood count are also helpful. For example, electrolytes in the blood, they will be decreased, whereas the electrolytes in the urine, they will be increased. Blood urea, nitrogen will be increased. Phosphate, calcium, they will be decreased. Urinalysis, that is microscopic and macroscopic, will show many changes, and the most common are urinary sediments. We will talk about that in a different slide. Quantitative urine protein, that means 24-hour urine protein, is also it will also be increased in cases of chronic kidney diseases, and most of the times it is greater than 3 grams per day. And spot ACR ratio, albumin to creatinine ratio, is also albumin to creatinine ratio is also less. So ultrasonography, the USG of the kidney will generally show shrunken kidney or the small size kidney in cases of CKD. And renal biopsy also tells us about the cause of diseases, cause of the chronic kidney disease. For example, if it is because of diabetic nephropathy, we can detect that diabetic nephropathy through renal biopsy as well. So this is the criteria for for classifying the chronic kidney disease or for staging the chronic kidney disease, and also the prognosis is also done by this chart. So according to the GFR, it is labeled under 5 categories: G1, G2, G3, G3A, G3B, G4 and G5. When the creatinine levels are normal, it is G1. When they are mildly decreased, that is 60 to 89, the GFR level is normal, right? It is G1 stage. When it is mildly decreased at 60 ml per minute, if it is mild to moderately decreased in the range of 45 G3, like that, and kidney failure if it is less than 15. Similarly, the albumin in the urine is also taken into the consideration. That means if the levels are less than 30 milligram per gram, that is 30 milligram per day, right, then it is A1 level. If it is between 30 to 300 milligram per day in 24 hours is lost, that means A2 level. If it is greater than 300 milligram, it is A3 level, and both of these are combined to find out the prognosis. The green is having good prognosis and the red is having bad prognosis. So what is the difference between AKI and CKD? The duration is, for the acute kidney injury, it is days to week. The kidney is affected for days to week, whereas for chronic kidney disease, the duration is in months to years. So the history itself tells us about whether the person is suffering with acute kidney injury or chronic kidney disease. Then the chronic symptoms are present only in chronic kidney disease. For example, if somebody is suffering with diabetes and diabetic nephropathy, which is a chronic kidney disease, then the symptoms will be available for a chronic period of time. Then reversibility, the AKIs are mostly reversible. The person reverses, the person's kidney reverses the injury and the person lives a healthy life, although he is much more susceptible for the next time injury. Whereas chronic kidney disease, it is irreversible. It gives permanent damage, which is progressive, and ultimately the person progresses into kidney failure. Then glomerular filtration rate. The glomerular filtration rate in AKI, it is low, whereas in CKD, it is usually stable. Low but stable. Whereas in AKI, it is progressively going down if not intervened. Then renal USG. Renal USG is, the USG shows in AKI mostly the kidney size is increased, whereas in chronic kidney disease, the kidney size are decreased. Oliguria. Oliguria means low output of urine, less than the desired, that is approximately 1 to 1.5 ml per kg. Oliguria is present in mostly in AKI, whereas in chronic kidney disease, polyuria is present in fact. Anemia, because the blood, the erythropoiesis is also regulated by kidney. So AKI is mostly absent in the anemia is absent in AKI, whereas in CKD it is generally, the person is generally having a anemia condition. So keep studying and do well.